Very good afternoon to all. Okay, I welcome you all for this another lecture of Industrial Hydraulics and Pneumatics subject. Okay, in the last lecture, we have started a discussion on rotary actuator. That means the another type of the hydraulic actuator. Okay, firstly we have gone for the linear actuator. That is the hydraulic cylinder. Now we are going for the rotary actuator. Okay. So the rotary actuator also it is named as the hydraulic motor. Getting it for the hydraulic for the rotary actuator means the your hydraulic motor. And I have explained about the types. Okay, that is introduction also we have discussed and types also we have discussed in the last lecture. That means the gear motor, vane motor, piston type motor. Getting it. And in the last lecture. We have started to have some videos regarding this point. So firstly, we'll go for the some videos about this point. Getting it? Here itself, I want to clear one concept is that whatever the types were discussed about the hydraulic linear cylinder, sorry, linear actuator or rotary actuator. That means the hydraulic cylinder or hydraulic motor. So same types will be there for the pneumatic part also, but for the pneumatic, its name will be the pneumatic cylinder. For the linear motion, pneumatic cylinder's name is there, linear cylinder. Okay, and for the rotary actuator in the pneumatic, it is named as air motors. Okay, as like in the hydraulic part, for the rotary actuator, we are calling it as a hydraulic motors. So same way for the pneumatic system, we are going to call it is as a air motor. Classification or the type, everything will be same. But the difference is that your working medium, that is the fluid, will be changed. For hydraulics, we are going to we are using the oil or the water. Okay, oil. Okay, most of or commonly oil is used, okay, as a fluid in the hydraulics. But in the pneumatic, pressurized air is used, okay, for the pneumatic. So that time for the rotary actuator in the pneumatic part, it is called air motor. Same types we are going to see. Gear motor, internal gear motor or external gear motor, GEO, that is a generated motor, okay. Then we are going to see the vane type motor or piston type motor. Again, when we are going to discuss about the pump, no? So for pump also, we are going to see the same types of the classification. Okay, in the pump also, you will get the type like this, like that a gear pump, vane pump, okay, piston type pump. Okay, that time you will come to know that. That point already, you will say that the same type already we have studied in the hydraulic part or the pneumatic part. Okay. So, due to that point only, I have given more concentration for the hydraulic part. Because once your hydraulic part will be clear, then it will be easy to you to understand about the pneumatic part. Getting it? Okay. Now, before going to start some videos regarding this rotary actuator. Okay. I want to just... need to confirm that whether my voice, whether my screen is visible at your ear and whether my video also. Okay, screen, video and audio. About that, just give me the confirmation whether all okay. Anybody? Sachin, Prashant, whether is visible, my video is visible. Okay, you can unmute yourself, no problem. Say yes, no. Okay. Okay. I got some messages. Okay. In the chat box. Okay. Okay. Same confirmation, please give me while I'm going to, while playing the video. Okay. So we'll go for the video also. Why I'm going to show, I'm showing some videos because through the videos, within a short period of time, you will get the more knowledge. Also, through the video, it will be easy to get because some visual effects you will get, okay? Some animated diagrams they are using in the videos, okay? To do that only, it will be easy to you to understand that, okay? So, last, in the yesterday lecture, I was showing the one video regarding the our rotor actuator, and in that gear motor. So we'll go for that only, then we'll go for vane motor. Okay, one by one we'll start.
In this video I explained the four types of rotary actuators or hydraulic or a pneumatic motors. First one is the external gear motor, second one is internal gear motor, third one is lob motors, and fourth one is the generated rotor motor. So first we understand the
tell me whether voice of video is audible at your end or not. Okay, in the chat box you just say yes or no, so that I will go for further. Whether voice is audible video wise, not my voice is audible. I know. Yes sir, audio. Okay, Prashant is there? Gorakh, Bhupendra Sondakke, Anil Dongre, whether Pramod Awadekar, whether my voice is my video voice is audible?
External gear motor. So from the name we can easily understand that the two gears are meshing externally. Okay, that's why it is called external gear. And what is the meaning of the motor? In a motor, we supplied the hydraulic or a pneumatic energy. Suppose it is the hydraulic motor, then we supplied the pressurized oil. Suppose it is pneumatic motors, then we supplied the compressed air or a gas. And output from the motor is the mechanical energy. Okay, means it is opposite to the hydraulic pump. In a pump, we supplied the mechanical energy and it is converted in a hydraulic energy. Okay, so we already studied external gear pumps. Okay, that's component are same, just the name is given. Okay, so figure show an external gear pump. It consists of two spur or a helical gears. Now in this image you see here the two gear is there and it is a spur gear and they are meshed with each other. Okay, so here name is given sub gears and idle gear, means this gear is produce the mechanical energy because this shaft is rotor and this is the idle gears. Okay, so in a external gear pump, what is the name of this gear is given, that is a driven gear and the driver gears. Okay, just here the name is changed, it is sub gears and idle gears, and these two gears are mesh with each other and mounted inside the casing. So here you see this is the outside this gear, the casing is provided. From these sides the pressurized oil or a compressed air is enters, and from this end it is the out, and this shaft is produced this mechanical energy. That's why its name is given the sub gear. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exert force on the gear teeth, due to which gear is rotated, shaft is rotated, and working fuel coming out from the outlet. From this end, suppose it is hydraulic motor, then the pressurized oil is supplied, and this pressurized oil is apply some force on the gears, and the gear is start to rotate, and from this end the oil is coming out, and the gear and the shaft is rotated, so we are able to achieve this mechanical energy. Second type is the internal gear motors. Okay. So in earlier we study external gear, here the internal gear means two gear are internally meshed, that's why its given name is given internal gear motor. So here you see this is the image of the internal gear motors. Okay, so internal gear motor means here you see this the internal gear means it is its provided insides. Okay, and inside this internal gear one external gear is mounted. External gear means it is outside on that. Okay, and in between these two gears the crescent seal is provided. This is the inlet and this is the outlet, and this outer body is called as the casing. It has two gear, one is having external teeth and another is having internal teeth. Okay, so this bigger gear means outside gear have a internal teeth and inside gear have a external teeth. The external gear is inside the internal gears. Okay, so in this image you see external gear teeth is inside the internal gear. The two gear are in mesh with each other. Here you see they are mesh with each other in this portion, A crescent seal is provided between these two gears which fills the gap between the two gears. Okay. Now here you see that is a space between these two gears is there, and this space is filled by using this seal. Okay, so this seal is provided in between two gears to fill this gap. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts a force on the gear teeth. Means from this end, the oil is supplied it on the hydraulics or a pneumatic motors, and it exerts the force on this gear teeth, and this gear are start to rotate. So this oil or a compressed air is applied the force on the gear teeth. Due to force, the gear is start to rotate and the shaft is also rotates, and working fluids come out from the outlet. Means from this end the working fluid is outlet. That's where the hydraulic or pneumatic energy is converted into the mechanical energy in a internal gear pump. Now moving on the lob pump. Before moving on that, I request to like the video and subscribe my channels for watching the more video related to the OHP. And the next one is the lob motors. Now here you see this is the diagrams of the lob motors, and it is similar to the external gear motors. Okay, but in this lob motors, instance of the spur or helical gears, this lob is used. Okay, in this lob, that is a simply three teeth is provided. So this is the shaft lob. Why its name is given shaft lob? Because lob is rotated at that time the shaft is rotated. Okay, and this shaft is give us the mechanical power. Here the idle lob. Okay, this lob is rotated but shaft is not rotated. That's why its name is given the idle lob. This outer part is the casing. This is the inlet of the oil as well as the air, depending upon the which type of the system is that, and this is the outlet. It consists of two rotor called lob. Means here you see this is the two rotors. So this rotor is known as the lob. That's why its system name is given the lob motors, which are in mass with each others and mounted inside the casing. Here you see there are mass with each other and they are installed in a casing. These lob have very less number of teeth, maybe 2, 3, or 4. Means lob have a number of teeth, means this is the one teeth, this is the second teeth, this is the third teeth. Means 2 lob type, 3 lob type, or 4 lob types of the lob motor is available. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts the force on the lob teeth, due to which the gear is rotated and the shaft is rotated and working fluid come out from the outlets. Next one is the G rotor, means generated rotor motor. So here you see this is the diagram of the generated motors. This is the inlet part, this is the outlet parts, and this part is the casing. Inside the casing you see there is a two rotor. One is the inner rotor and second one is the outer rotor. So here you see this the animations of the generated motor. This motor consists of two generated rotor as shown in this figure. Means here the two generated rotor is there. Okay, in this animation you see that it is one is the white colors and second one is the internal. Means it's same as like as the internal gear motors. Okay, but it is called as the generated rotor. So here you see this inside rotor have a external teeth and outside rotor have a internal teeth. One is having external teeth and another is having internal teeth. Same I already explained. Here you see in this image, this is the external teeth rotor and outside that it is the internal teeth rotor. The rotor with external teeth rotated inside the rotor with external teeth rotated inside the rotor having a internal teeth. The inner rotor is having the one teeth less than that of the outlet rotors. Means external teeth rotor is rotated inside these internal teeth rotors, and inner rotor is having the one teeth less than that of the outer rotor. Means compared to the outer rotors, the inlet rotor have a one teeth less than the outer rotors. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts a force on the gear teeth. Means from this end, the suppose it is the hydraulic motor, then pressurized oil is supplied, and suppose it is pneumatic system, then compressed air or a gas is supplied. So when this air or a oil is supplied to the inlet, it exerts a force on this gear teeth okay, and due to which the gear is start to rotate, and when the gear is start to rotate, this shaft is also rotated, and the working fluid is come out from this outlet. That's where the hydraulics or pneumatic energy is converted into a mechanical energy. So thank you for watching this video. If you learn something, then like the video and subscribe my channels and share with your friend.
Okay, so this was about the gear motor, okay, external, internal and globe motor that we have seen. Now let us go for the another one, that is a our vane motor. Okay, vane motor.
In this video I explain two types of rotary actuators, means it is the hydraulic motors or a pneumatic motors. First type is the unbalanced vane motors, and second type is the balanced vane motors. So first we understand the unbalanced vane motors. So here you see, this is the diagrams of the unbalanced vane motor. It consists of cylindrical rotor. So here you see, this is the cylindrical rotor, this blue color portion, okay, and this rotor is mounted in a circular casing. Okay, this is the outer part, is the circular casing, and inside this circular casing the cylindrical rotor is mounted within offset. Okay, what is the meaning of offset? The center of this rotor and center of the casings are different. So casing center is somewhere here you see this cursor, okay, and center of the rotor is here. So this distance is called as the offset. So due to this offset, here you see this, the gap is somewhere more and somewhere less. Okay, here gap is maximum, here the gap between the rotor and casing is zero, here the space is lower between the rotors and casings, and it is increasing here. Okay, and it is called as the left side, and this is the right sides of the unbalanced vane motors. This is the inlet, this is the outlet, and here you see, this is the inside this cylindrical rotor the various vane slot is provided. Okay, so this white color inside the cylindrical block is a various slot, and inside these slots the vanes are installed. So here you see, this is the rotor, and inside this rotor here I show only the one slot, but in a actual there is a number of slot is there, and inside this slot this van is provided, and this van is moving up and down. Okay, so at that point the van is completely inside these slots. Okay, here you see, in this case the van is outside the slots. Okay, that's why we need to the movement of the van inside and outside. The vanes are seated in a radial slots of the rotor and hold against the casing by spring or a hydraulic force. Means how these vanes are moving up and down. So it is up and down due to the spring force or a hydraulic force. Means some spring attachment is provided, or due to the hydraulic force they move up and down. Hence there will not be any leakage of working fluids between the van tips and the casing. So this part is the van tips and this is called as the casing. Okay, so in between van tips and casing there is a no chances of the leakage, because these vanes are the spring force or a hydraulic force types. Okay, so they are not give any space between this van and the casing, so there is a zero leakage between this casing and the van. When working fluid is supply to the inlet, means from this inlet the working fluid is supply. Suppose it is the hydraulic system, then the oil is supply, and suppose the pneumatic system, then compressed air or gas is supplied, and this fluid is exert a force on this van. Means suppose oil is supplied and oil is applied the force on the van, and due to that cylindrical rotor is rotated. Means this rotor is start to rotate, and this rotor is mounted on the shaft, so shaft is also start to rotate, and working fluid is come out from the outlets, and finally this shaft is generate this mechanical energy. Okay, why its name is given the unbalance? Because at the inlet here the high pressure is there, and at the outlet that is a low pressure is there. Due to this pressure difference there is a change in the force. Higher pressure means higher force, because the force is directly proportional to the pressures. Okay, here the low pressure means the lower the force. So due to this pressure difference, unbalanced forces is created on the shaft and the bearing. That's why it is called as the unbalanced vane motors. Now second we understand the balanced vane motors. Now before moving on that, I request to like the video and subscribe my motors. In this type of motor, two image of the balance card. Now here you see this is the image of the balance van motors. In this type of motor, two inlet and two outlets are provided. So here you see this is the one inlet, this is the second inlet and two outlet, one outlet and second outlet. These two outlet is provided to avoid the unbalanced forces on the shaft and the bearing. Okay, and we are achieve the balance force on the shaft and the bearing. That's why its name is given the balance van motor. Means disadvantage of the unbalanced van motor is solved in a balanced van pump by providing the two inlet and two outlet. The center axis of the rotor and that of the electrical casing are the same. Okay, means here you see this is the rotor. Okay, inside the rotor various slot is provided. Inside these slots of the rotor various van is there. Okay, and here you see which type of the casing shape is provided. Casing shape is the electricals. Okay, and center of this electrical casing and the center of the rotor is same. Okay, that means here the center axis of the rotor and the electrical casing are same. That's why here you see this space on the every side is the equal. Okay, here you see this space is smaller, here same way space is smaller, and inlet is matched here. Okay, this the inlet is occur here and outlets from this side. Same way inlet is from this side and outlet is from these sides. Means in these two holes between these vans, the inlet is done. Then after here the pressure is reduced and this outlet is from this side. Same way oil or air is enter in this space, then move here and is out. Pressure loading still occurs, means pressure loading is still there, but two identical halves of the motor created equal but opposite loads. Means both side forces in opposite directions, but the amount are equals. Okay, so equal but opposite load on the motor shaft and the bearing. Hence the balanced van motors give the better service and the larger life compared to the unbalanced van motors. When the working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts the force on the vans. So here working fluid is supplied from these two sides, okay, and it exerts the force on the van, and due to that the cylindrical rotor is rotated. This rotor is start to rotate. So this rotor is mounted on the shaft, so shaft is also start to rotate and working fluid comes out from this outlet. Okay, that means shaft is balanced. That's why its name is given the balanced van motors. Suppose it is the hydraulic motor, then hydraulic oil is supplied, and pneumatic system, then the pneumatic means compressed air or a gas is supplied. So thank you for watching this video. If you like,
whether you got the point about the van motor, in that again balanced motor, van motor and unbalanced van motor. Okay, understood? Okay, understood or not, just tell me in the chat box yes or no, so that I can proceed further for the that piston type motor. Please reply. Gear motor, van motor. Okay, these are same power in the hydraulic part, pneumatic part also. Okay, in the pump also. Okay, please tell me in the chat box whether you understood or not, please. Okay, let us go for another one. Okay, I have covered this gear motor, then we have gone for the this unbalanced and balanced van motor. Okay, we'll go for this piston type motor. Okay,
these in are this also video, I explained the two types of rotary actuators or a rotary motors, or we also say that it is the hydraulic motors or a pneumatic motor. First one is the stationary cylinder radial piston motor, And second one is the rotating cylinder radial piston motors. So from the name you can understand, in this case cylinder are stationary, that's why it is called as the stationary cylinder. In the second case cylinder are rotated, that's why it is called as the rotating cylinder types. So first we understand the stationary cylinder radial piston motor. So its construction is similar as the stationary cylinder radial piston pump. Okay, in a pump we supply the mechanical energy as a input, in a motor we achieve the mechanical energy as a output. Figure show stationary cylinder type radial piston motors. So now in this case here you see this is a 5 stationary cylinder are there, this 1 2 3 4 and 5. Inside the 5 cylinders the individual piston are provided and all the piston have the connecting rod. Okay, these are the connecting rod and all the connecting rod are connected with one common crank. Okay, and in this image you are not see the suction and delivery valve, but suction and delivery valve is provided at the head of the cylinder, means here is provided in a second, here is provided. Okay, it consists of stationary cylinder block in which 5 cylinders are arranged coplanar with equal angle between them, means between the every cylinders that is a equal angle is there. Okay, and inside this 5 cylinder 5 piston is there and this cylinder are stationary, that's why its name is given the stationary cylinder radial piston pump. Totally there are 5 pistons, one reciprocating inside the each other, means they are reciprocate inside the cylinders. All the pistons are connected to a single crank by individual connecting rod as shown in these figures that I already explained, that every pistons have a different connecting rod but one common crank, means that is a 5 cylinder, 5 piston, 5 connecting rod but one crank. All the suction valves are connected to a single suction pipe and all the delivery valves are connected to a single delivery pipe, means here the 5 cylinder is there, means in every cylinder one suction valve and one delivery valve, means that is a 5 cylinder, means 5 suction valve and 5 delivery valve is there. Okay, so these 5 suction valves are connected with one common suction pipe and 5 delivery valve is connected with the one common delivery pipe. Okay, when working fluid is supplied to the inlet it exert the force on the piston, means suppose in this cylinder the suction valve is provided here, from this valve, means in every cylinders there is a suction and delivery timing is different, because here you see this in a these 2 cylinders the piston is up there completely at the bottom dead center, but here on the top dead center, here in these middles. Okay, means there is a some difference between the suction in every cylinder, suction is not done at the same times. Okay, so working fluid is supplied to the inlet, suppose in these cylinders, okay, that is in the topmost position, so we consider here suppose we supplied the hydraulic oil or a compressed air or a gas, suppose it is the pneumatic systems. Okay, when we supply these working fluids to the inlet it exert the force on the pistons and the piston is start to move in the towards the bottom to the bottom dead center BDC. Okay, and the connecting rod is also move and they rotate this crank. Okay, so when the working fluid is supplied to the inlet it exert the force on the pistons due to which the crank is rotated and the crank is connected with this shaft, here in the center you see shaft is there, so shaft is rotated, that means we achieve the mechanical energy. Okay, and the working fluid is coming out from the outlet of the cylinder. Before moving ahead I request to like the video and subscribe my channel for watching the more video related to the OHP and the other subject of the mechanical engineering. For the OHP various link is provided in descriptions as well as in a card mean on a top right screen of your laptop or mobile you see the eye symbols, rotating cylinder radial piston motor, means in this case the cylinder are rotated, not the stationary. In earlier case the cylinder are stationary, now here you see this is the diagram of the rotating cylinder radial piston motors. This motor is consist of rotating cylinder block which is mounted with an offset inside the casing. Now here you see this section type view is our cylinder block, here you see the cylinder block name is mentioned. Inside this cylinder block various radial holes are provided or a radial boards are provided. Okay, so how many holes are provided is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 holes are provided, and inside this hole the pistons are reciprocated. Here you see these pistons are provided. Okay, and this end of the piston is connected with this reaction ring. Here you see this is the reaction ring is mentioned, and this is the casing. Okay, now there is a not common centers between the cylinder block and the casing. Okay, casing center is slightly here and cylinder block center is here. That is called as the offset between the casing and the cylinder block. That's why here the offset word is mentioned. The casing has reaction ring with which the piston remains in contact while the cylinder block is rotating. Means when the cylinder block is rotating, at that time the pistons are continuously contact with this reaction ring. This is achieved by centrifugal force and the pressure of the liquid. Means how the cylinder blocks are in contact with the reaction rings. They are in contact with the reaction ring due to the centrifugal force and the pressure of the liquid. So we know that when the some things are rotated, they are tried to move away from the center due to the centrifugal force. Okay, the same things we are feeling in our bike or a car when we take the turn at the very high speeds. Okay, so generally we take the turn, our car is moving in this away from the center of the circles. The piston are assembled inside the radial boards of the cylinder block that we already discussed. In a cylinder block, that is here 9 boards are provided in a radial directions, and inside this bore or a hole the pistons are provided. Inlet port and outlet port are located as shown in this figure. So in a center part of the rotor, here you see that the inlet and outlet ports are provided, and these inlet and outlet ports are separated by using the pintle. So here you see this is a one pintle is provided in between the inlet and outlet ports. Means the pintle is separate the inlet port and the outlet port. When the working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exert a force on the piston. So from this port the inlet of the oil is coming. Suppose it is the hydraulic motors, and suppose it is pneumatic motors, then compressed air or a gas is coming. Okay, so this fluid is applied the force on the piston. Okay, so here written it exert the force on the piston due to which cylinder block is rotated. So this cylinder block is start to rotate in this directions, and when the cylinder block is rotated, the shaft is also start to rotate. So shaft rotate and working fluid come out from the outlet. Means from this outlet the working fluid go to the tank or a reservoirs. So thank you for watching this video. If you learn something, then like.
Okay, so this was about the piston type of motor. Okay, hydraulic motor. Okay, now we have another straight axis piston motor and bent axis piston motor, that also we will see.
In this video, I explain two types of rotary actuators. In this video, I explain two type of rotary actuators, means hydraulic motor or a pneumatic motor. First one is the straight axis piston motor, and second one is the bent axis piston motor. First, we understand the straight axis piston motor. Straight axis piston motor is shown in figure. Now here you see this is the diagram of the straight axis piston motor. The construction of the straight axis piston motor is same as the straight axis piston pump. Okay, just input and output is changed. In a pump we supply the mechanical energy as a input. Okay, in a motors we achieve the mechanical energy as a output. In a straight axis piston motor, the cylinder block is fitted to the driver shaft. Now here you see this is the cylinder block. Inside the cylinder block the number of hole is provided, and inside this hole this piston is reciprocates. Okay, and this cylinder is connected with this driver shaft. Here you see this green color portion is the driver shaft. This blue color portion is the cylinder block. Here it's mentioned, and in the cylinder block various hole is provided. The axis of rotation of cylinder block and the driver shaft are same. Means here you see that is a straight axis is there. Means axis of the cylinder block and axis of the driver shaft are same. That's why it is called as the straight axis piston motor. Now inside this cylinder block, two hole is there, and inside this hole, this piston one is mounted, and here you see the second piston is there. Okay. So depending on this requirement, in a cylinder block, 8 to 12 holes are provided and 8 to 12 pistons are provided. The shoe plate is mounted on a swass plate which is fixed at an angle to the axis of rotations. Now this piston is connected with this shoe plate here by using this ball joint or a spherical joints. Okay. And this shoe plate is connected with this swass plate. Okay. And they are in the installs on this driven shaft. The angle of swiss plate can be varied to change the speed of the motors. Means if we need to change the speed of the motors, we need to change this angle of this swiss plate. Okay. And if we change the angle of swiss plate, we are able to change the speed of the motor. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts the force on the pistons. Means here you see there is a one inlet is provided, and here this outlet is there. Okay. From this inlet we supplied the hydraulic oil. If this is the hydraulic motors and suppose it is the pneumatic motors, then we supplied the compressed air or a gas. So when this working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts the force on the piston. Okay. So when this oil or a gas is applied the force on the piston, piston is start to reciprocate, and due to this reciprocation the cylinder block is also start to rotate. So due to which cylinder block rotate, and the cylinder block it is attached with the shaft, so shaft is also start to rotate, and the working fluid come out from the outlet. So from this end the working fluid is coming out. So our main function is to achieve the mechanical energy, and this mechanical energy is achieved by using this shaft. Now before moving on the second type, I request to like the video and subscribe my channel. Is provided in descriptions as well as in a card mean on a top right screen. Visit the playlist of my channels. Now the second type is the bent axis piston pump. Why its name is given the bent axis piston pump? Because the cylinder block axis and this shaft axis are different. Means they are at the certain angles. That's why it is called as the bent axis piston motor. Bent axis piston motor is shown in this figure. They have same components. Okay. So here you see this is the inlet, this is the outlet. This is the cylinder block. Here they already mentions inside the block hole is provided, in a hole piston is there. Okay. And here additionally universal joint is added. Here you see this name is given universal joints. Okay. And instance of the swiss plate, the name is used, that is a flange. Okay. And this flange is connected with the shaft. So this is the cylinder block. Inside the cylinder block various hole is provided, and inside the holes the piston is reciprocates and cylinder block is rotated. In bent axis piston motor, the shoe plate is fixed to a flange, and the flange is key to the driver shaft. Means in a earlier case, means in a straight axis piston motor, the shoe plate and swiss plates are installed on a driver shaft, means a shaft of the motor. But in this case, the shoe plate is fixed to the flange, means shoe plate and the flange are mix, and this flange are key to the driver shaft. Means by using the key joint, the flange is fit on the driver shaft. That's why it is a key to the driver shaft. What is mentioned? The axis of cylinder block and that of the flange are intersecting at angles. So here you see this is the axis of the cylinder is this. Okay, they are at the certain angles, and this is the axis of the shaft. Okay. This axis of the shaft or axis of the flange, okay, and they are intersecting at the certain angles. That's why it is called as the bent axis piston motor. A universal link couple means universal joint couple the flange and the cylinder block. So here you see this is the block, cylinder block, and this is the flange or a shaft, and they are connected by using these universal joints. Here you see this is the universal joint is coupled the cylinder block as well as the flange. When working fluid is supplied to the inlet, it exerts the force on the piston. So from this end, suppose the oil is enters, okay, they applied some force on the piston and piston is start to reciprocate and cylinder is start to block due to the pressure of oil or a compressed air or gas. And when the piston is start to reciprocate, means the inlet fluid is applied some force on the piston due to which the cylinder block is rotated. And cylinder block is rotated, so cylinder block is attached with the flange and the shaft by using this universal joint. Okay, means rotational motions of the cylinder block is transferred to the shaft. Okay, and working fluid is coming out from the outlet, means working fluid is coming out from some another holes. In this video, I explained the rotary actuators or a rotary motors. So, first classifications of the rotary actuator is the limited rotation actuators. And in limited rotation actuator, there is a two type. First one is the vane type and second one is the piston type. Okay, so I explained the two types of the rotary actuators in this video, vane types and piston type rotary actuators. So, first we understand the meaning of the rotary actuators. Rotary actuator are also called motor. They produce rotation of shaft and torque when the fluid under the pressure is supplied. Okay, so in a rotary actuators or a rotary motors, we supply the hydraulic energy as a input, and output from the rotary motor is the rotation of the shaft. Means we get the rotational energy, means it's called as the mechanical energy. Okay, so in a electric motor, what happen, we supply electricity and it is converted in the rotational energy, means mechanical energy. Same way in a hydraulic motors or a rotary motors, we supply the hydraulic energy and it is converted into a mechanical energy. Limited rotation actuator means these motor are bidirectional motor. Bidirectional motors means they are rotated in two directional, clockwise and anti-clockwise. They can run in a both the direction, but for a limited number of rotations. Okay, they are not continuously rotated in one direction. They are only rotated in a one directional in a few rotations. Okay, then after they start to rotate in other direction, that is called as the limited rotations actuators. So first we understand vane type rotary actuators. Now here you see, this is the image of the vane type rotary actuators. This is the cylinder block and this outer part is the casing. On this casing, here you see two port is provided, port A and port B. Inside this cylinder block, one slot is provided, and in this slot the vane is moving up and down. So it has cylindrical block with a pair of finely ground flat vanes in a radial slots. Means one radial slot is provided and it is a finely ground. Okay, and in this slot the vane is provided. Now here you see, this is the rotor. Okay, inside this rotor, this is the one slot is provided, and inside the slot this vane is putted, and the vane is moving up and down on the basis of this radius of the casing. Okay, so this cylinder block is mounted offset with this casing. Okay, so casing center is somewhere here, but you see the cylinder block center is here, means it is called as the offset. Okay, so when it is fitted on the offset, so here you see that the vane is completely outside, means majority portion is outside. But when this vane is coming here, so vane is moving inside. When the vane is come here, it is completely inside these slots. Okay, so that's where this design is done. When working fluid is supplied through port A, means from the port A the working fluid is supplied, it exerts the pressure on a vane, means the hydraulic oil or a, suppose it is the pneumatic system, then compressed air is applied the pressure on the vane, and hence the motor shaft is the rotated in a counterclockwise direction. Means suppose from the port A oil is supplied, then it is rotated in this direction, it is called as the counterclockwise. Opposite is also possible, that is a supplied from the port B, then it is rotated in a clockwise directions. So in a every types of the hydraulic motors, means it is not called only hydraulic motor, it is also pneumatic motor, depending on the which fluid we supplied inside the motor. When working fluid is supplied through port B, the motor shaft is rotated in a clockwise directions. Now before moving on the second times, I request to like the video and subscribe. type. In a piston type, it is called as the rack and pinion types. Okay. Now here you see this is a image. Okay, this is image for the drawing examination. It is a general schematic diagram. Here the port A is provided at the center of the cylinder. Here the port B is provided. Okay, and at the center pinion is there, and both the sides of the pinions, that is the rack, is provided. Okay, so same diagram you see in this image, means it is a different way it is drawn. Okay, this is the cylinder. Inside the cylinder piston is there, and with this piston the rack is provided. Here you see on this top view, here the rack is provided, and this rack is able to rotate this pinion. Okay, it has the cylinder inside with two pistons are mounted. So here you see this is the cylinder. Inside the cylinder two piston is there, means there is a two different cylinder. Same way here, this is the cylinder. Inside the cylinder, that is a two piston is there. Okay, this is only one cylinder, but this type is also possible. In that case, you see the two different cylinder is there. Connection from port A is taken from either end of the cylinder as shown in these figures. Okay, so from the port A, oil is supplied. Then from this passage, it is enter on this side on for the left side pistons, and oil is also moving from this passage and it is supplied at this end. Means oil is supplied on a both the end of the cylinder from the port A. Connection of port B is taken at the middle of the cylinders. Okay, here you see this connection of the port B is provided at the middle of the cylinder. When working fluid is supplied from port A, it exerts the pressures on the piston from either end of the cylinders. Means from the port A, oil is supplied and they go to the either sides of the pistons and they apply some force on the piston. The piston is moved towards the each others. Means towards the each other means they are coming near to each others. Okay, means when we supply this oil, here you see this port A is provided here and here. Okay, so when this oil is supplied from the both end, the pistons are, this piston is moving towards the right side and this piston is moving towards the left side. Means they are going near to the each other. Means move towards the each others. Okay, in this image, oil is supplied from this side and this side. Okay, and both the sides the oil is applied the pressure on the piston. So this piston is moving to right side and this piston is moving to left sides. The piston move towards the each others and working fluid flow out through the port B at the middle of the cylinders. Okay, so from the middle ports the oil is supplied back to the tank or a reservoirs. The piston are fitted with the rack and pinion arrangement. So here in this image you see that piston is connected with this rack. Okay, this side piston is also connected with another rack. This rack is connected with this pinion. Okay, so in this image you clearly understand that. So this piston is connected with this rack and this piston is connected with this rack, and then this rack is connected with this pinion. Okay, so pistons are fitted with the rack and pinion arrangement. Hence the piston is rotated in a counterclockwise directions. Okay, so when the oil is supplied from port A, at that time this piston is moving right side, so rack is also moving right sides, and they rotate this pinion in a counterclockwise directions. When the working fluid is supplied through the port B, it exerts the pressure on the piston from inside out of the cylinder. Means when the working fluid is supplied from the port B, means from this port B it is supplied to the cylinders, then what happens? The piston is moving away from the each others. Okay, so this left side piston is moving left side, right side piston is moving right side. Means space between the two piston is increased. It's called as they are moving away from the each others. At that time this pinion is rotated in a clockwise directions. So this piston is move away from each other and the working fluid flow out through the port A, hence the pinion is rotated in a clockwise directions. So thank you for watching.
Okay, so this was about the our hydraulic motors. One small point is remaining that we'll see, then we'll stop for this lecture. Okay, one small point is remaining. That is a cylinder with cushioning. At that point we will see.
I explain cylinder with cushionings. Why cushioning is required? What happen if we not use the cushioning? And how the cushioning is work in a cylinders? If the cylinder is long, and cylinder is long, then what the stroke length is more. Okay, stroke length means the distance between the two end, means distance travel by the piston, it's called as the stroke. So this stroke length is more if the cylinder is long and speed is high, piston speed is high, then naturally the piston impact on the end cover is considerably high. Means if the piston velocity is high, then the piston is strike with the end cover, means piston is strike with the cap end and the rod end. Okay, and when the piston is strike with this cap end and rod ends, it's damage the cap end and the rod end, and we need to replace it after the sometimes. So avoid these things, we need to use the cushionings in a cylinders. Okay, and if you use the cushioning in the cylinders, okay, the piston is not strike with the end. Okay, and it's avoid the damaging of the rod ends. Okay, so how it is cushioning is achieved? Cushioning is achieved by, okay, the piston is not strike. Okay, so how it is velocity near the rod end or a cap end, means near the end we are reducing the speed of the piston and approximate zero towards the end. So how it is achieved, that we discuss later on. So when we are not using the cushioning, then what happen? Continuous hammering of the piston on this cover plate and cause the loosening of tie rods and leakage of the fluids. Also it will damage the cover plate. Hence, to avoid the sudden impact of piston on the cover plate, cylinder with cushionings are used. So I hope you can clearly understand why cushioning is required and what happen if you not use the cushionings. Okay. Now cylinder with cushioning is shown in this figure. Now in this figure you see this portion is the cylinder. Okay, and this is the cap end side of the cylinder, this is the inlet. Okay, and here the cushioning existing screw is there, and here you see one additional check valve is used. Why this check valve is provided, that I discuss later on. Here o-ring is there. Okay, this is the piston and this is the piston rod. In a piston, on a left side we use the piston nose to do the cushioning effect. This cushioning with the cylinder has integral flow control valve, check valve in its end cover plates. So here you see this on the end cover plates the check valve is provided. The piston rod has projected nose equal to the diameter of inlet port passage. Now on the piston, here you see that piston nose is provided, and this piston nose diameter is equal to the diameter of inlet port passage. Means here you see this inlet port passage is there. Okay, so this diameter of the inlet port passage and the diameter of the piston nose are same. During retraction, piston is moved towards the left, means during retraction strokes the piston is start to move from right to left side. Okay, and nose is entered the port, means this nose is enter in this port. Okay, and when this nose is enter in a port, what happen? Only the reticulated passage through the FCV is left, and hence the flow is reduced and resulting in further movement of the piston is slow. Means flow is reduced on these sides and the piston velocity is reduced. Okay, so when this piston nose is enter in this passage, so reticulated flow is coming from the FCV and is reduced the further movement of the piston, means reduce the further movement of the piston, means reduce the velocity of the piston. This how the cushioning is achieved. So simple meaning of cushioning is the slow end of stroke. Slow end of the stroke means when the piston velocity is reduced, it is not strike to the cover and the stress on the cover is reduced. During extension, the piston is moving toward right. Okay, now when the retraction stroke is over, then what happened? This nose is completely inside this passage and the piston is on these positions. Okay, then how the flow is coming? So flow is coming from inlet these sides. Okay, so flow is not coming. So for the flow, here the check valve is provided. Okay, so during extension, when the piston is moving towards the right, working fluid is supplied to inlet ports. Means at the starting of extension, this piston is completely here and this nose is completely inside this passage. Okay, so inlet is not coming directly to the cylinders. Okay, so oil is first enter in this check valve, and from this check valve they applied the force on the piston and piston is start to move towards the right sides, left to right sides, and this is called as the extension strokes. Now since This port is closed by the nose. Means when we supplied the inlet oils, the passage is closed by this nose. Working fluid has to flow through the restricted passage of FCV. It will not produce sufficient force to start the movement of the pistons. So oil is coming from this restricted passage of the FCV, and this will not produce sufficient force to start the movement of the piston. Hence the check valve is provided. Okay, here you see the hence the check valve is provided through which working fluid flow freely and move the piston. So at the starting of the extension, this nose is completely inside the passage, and the oil coming from the FCV are not able to move the pistons. Okay, that's why the check valve is provided. So oil coming from the FCV is entering this check valve, and the check valve is applied the force on the piston, and piston is start to move. Now, what is the application of the cylinder with Kuznings? So it is used in a various types of the packing machines, material handling machines. This Kuznings is used in a hydraulic as well as pneumatic both the systems. So thank you.
Okay, so I think you got the information regarding the our rotary actuators. Okay, and the last one which we have covered about the that cylinder with the Kuznings. Now from the first point, only one small bit is remaining, that is a seal sand packing, that we will discuss tomorrow. Okay, please remember that whatever the type of the hydraulic actuator, okay, it may be linear, it may be rotary, whatever we have seen, what I have discussed, the same type we are going to learn in the pneumatic section also. Okay, so don't worry about that. So I hope you understood. Now I request you all, please write down your roll number in the chat box, and you can leave this meeting, no problem. Okay, please write down your roll number in the chat box. And after writing your roll number, you can leave this meeting, no problem. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, see you tomorrow.